did, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Well.
Hi, how are you doing? Hi.
Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, my name is Chris Mendez. I'm Cutting Edge's representative. If you could introduce yourself, please.
Yeah, my name is Mauricio Aguero, and I'm representing Chris Jones here. Was a former employee of Cutting Edge. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you as well.
So, great to be here, Chris. Before we start all of this, just want to make sure you're the attorney, right? So, you have authority to close the settlement right here, or do you need
Within limits, absolutely.
Okay.
Like, I do have authority to strike a deal within limits. And
okay.
It depends on some of the details, but perfect.
Just to get it out.
Okay, so. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, well, Chris, in the spirit of negotiation, I would like to maybe discuss some time allocations as to how we're going to organize this negotiation. And I was thinking, you know, it's open to suggestions, obviously.
Absolutely.
That maybe we could devote the first hour to just discussing both our parties' interests. And, like, the last 30 minutes of a negotiation, that means, like, we're going to have an hour and 30 minutes to negotiate, of course. Just try to focus on really finding a solution.
Yeah, so I'm going to just write it down real quick, right on agenda. Okay, so the first hour, you know, talking about interests and...
Obviously, it can be shorter.
Yeah,
but I'm just saying, like, provided that we're within an hour and still discussing interests, maybe we should try to, you know, talk about solutions after that hour.
Yeah, absolutely. That sounds great. I was wondering, you know, one thing I would like to add, you know, probably make a little bit more sense during the hours as part of the hour is also just kind of, you know, and also, you know, towards the beginning, just throwing out ideas, at the front end before perhaps, I don't know what you're thinking, before we exchange information, just like possibilities in regards to what are the different components that a deal might look like, just throwing everything that we could think about, because perhaps, you know, as we talk about interests, we have, you know, get some more of that knowledge, I'm thinking, it'll just make it easier to get, like, constantly cross-reference with, you know, just various ideas. And when it comes to the actual negotiation, we could just more easily pull if we're looking at a list of possibilities. What do you think?
Sure, I think it makes complete sense. No, my interest was mainly just to make sure that we don't drag it out discussing, like, our each party's position and then run out of time.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so
1 hour for information gathering, discussing possibilities and ideas, and then half an hour to, you know, try to come to agreement on terms. And
that's like our extreme scenario. Obviously, we can.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I'm.
I think that's great. I think that's a great start.
I'm gonna put my stopwatch. I don't know if I'm gonna put yours as well, so you can keep track of time, or should just we rely on mine.
I could put mine on as well, just in case. Yeah. It'll probably make it easier, sure not, yeah.
When you want to check time and stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
So, Chris, you're from around here originally, right? Or not?
I'm originally from, I'm originally from the Midwest.
Over the
Chicago area.
Chicago. Oh, yeah, so you're definitely used to the cold.
Yeah, definitely used to the cold. You only get used to it to a degree, though. I still don't like the cold every time. But what about yourself?
I'm from Paraguay, South America. So we have very warm weather, and this cold is, you know, pretty cold for me.
What's the coldest usually gets?
The coldest it can get up to get down to 0 degrees.
Mm.
But the thing is, it's not as intense. For example, right now it's like almost noon and it's 0 degrees.
Yeah.
It will get 0 degrees like 6 a.m. in the morning on a very cold day, and then it will reach, I don't know, to 8 degrees. I'm sorry, that's Celsius, by the way.
Yeah.
That's Fahrenheit. So it'll be like 32 degrees Fahrenheit in the real morning. And then by noon, it will be like 60 degrees or so. Or, I don't know, 50 or something.
And right now, in this part of the year, it's really warm, right?
Yeah.
Because it's really summer,
warm.
Yeah.
It's really,
yeah.
Really
that's
warm.
Great, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I'll do for some warm weather right now.
Yeah. Okay, so, down to business. Yeah.
So,
well, I guess, are you familiar with the background of the story, or do you want to just maybe go over it a little bit?
Yeah. You know, I'm familiar with some of the you know, some of the basics of the case. And, you know, I also have, you know, some follow-ups of questions in regards to, you know, to exactly what happened. I think that could kind of, you know, help, you know, just, you know, to get what Chris's perspective is, you know, what happened. I think that would be very helpful because I'm sure there's still a lot of information that we don't have yet. So, yeah, I was just wondering if you could tell me a little bit about, you know, where Chris is coming from. You know, in regards to not only the claim, but, you know, also like the work environment.
Okay. Cutting edge. So I'm gonna try to provide a brief summary of
Chris's
perspective on this case. As you know, recently she came clean about her sexual orientation to her coworkers, and she told them that she has decided to adopt a baby, and short thereafter, her coming clean, she started feeling some hostility in the workplace, which had really affected her work performance as well. Obviously, no one wants to work in an environment like that. Some of the issues that she had mentioned to me are that at one point, they exchanged emails between co-workers, calling her offensive names. Mm-hmm. In one of which even the manager of the company was copied in. So she was really, I don't know, not upset, but obviously upset, but rather alarmed that him being copied in the email had not done anything to discipline her co-workers. And another event that really, really disturbed her was the fact that they put a pornographic image on her desk at one point, like a lesbian pornographic image, which is obviously very disturbing, I mean, for any person. But for someone in her position, having the courage to come out and receiving this hostile environment is obviously very tough. And there was a lot of issues for her. Like, she had really a lot of trouble sleeping, so she was tired when she was coming to work. And obviously, you feel conscious. I mean,
yeah.
It's not, I don't want to say fun, I mean, it's not the word fun, but you don't feel as comfortable working in an environment where the environment is hostile. So, like, logically, when she was there, she was just, let me put it in this another way. She had been working in the company for 16 years, right?
Right.
And she had done very good. She climbed her way up from a programmer to a software development manager. And she loved her job, obviously. I mean, she was the first one to go to college in her family. She is very proud of her achievements in the technology field. And all of a sudden, for her to have to come to work and be, okay, let's just get this over with.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, it's a real blow, and when she got fired, it came as a real surprise to her, because she was enduring all of this, you know, because of the sake of the company and her job, and mostly because she had done so much for the company to be where it is right now. So in sum, she's very upset.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, first and foremost, I just want to say that, you know, I'm sorry that, you know, she, you know, that this happened, that, you know, in the workplace, you know, Cutting Edge as an employer does not stand for this. And, you know, acts such as this are not okay. So I just want to make that clear. So I had a couple of questions in regards to, yeah, like exactly what happened and what were some of the procedures, you know, or the things that, you know, occurred, like, after, you know, she began.
Mm-hmm.
You know, or after she saw emails, you know, after she saw the pictures that were on her chair. So did she raise these concerns with her manager or direct supervisor or anyone?
Well, on the case of the email,
yeah,
she did not raise the concern directly.
Okay.
Mainly because she didn't see the need to do it, since he was copied in the email. So he was obviously aware of the fact that there had been some hostility going on. And as a result of that special situation, that she was like, she saw the manager being aware and did not do anything. She just felt that raising a concern again due to the pornographic image would just be like a futile effort. So she did not do it as well. Having said that, that does not mean that our party stands for, like, we believe that even though a concern has not been formally raised, mm-hmm. I mean, it's obviously in the duty of the employer to ensure a safe environment. So mainly because of those two issues, she did not raise the concerns. One's because he was aware of it, and second, yeah. regardless of whether she makes a formal complaint, we're under the assumption that an employer has to ensure a safe environment for the workers. So she felt that he would take care of it once he became aware of it, which obviously he did, but he did not take care of it.
Okay. Yeah. And I want to. Do you know why she didn't, you know, raise the issue? Was it just a matter of she wasn't comfortable with raising the issue with a supervisor or a manager, or was there some other reason?
What do you mean?
I was just wondering, like, why she didn't raise the issue with one of her managers. And I'm not attaching any value judgments, to it. But, I was just wondering, was it a matter of she just wasn't comfortable with discussing this in the workplace, what happened to her? Or was it that she was, like, concerned perhaps about, having additional issues at the workplace? Or was there some other reason?
Well, like I said, she mainly didn't raise the issue because mm-hmm. she knew that they were aware of it already.
Okay, yeah.
And even so, like, even if they were aware of it, I mean, I believe you understand, like, the complexities of raising issues such
Absolutely.
As that. I mean,
Absolutely.
It's not often you feel comfortable in saying, hey, come on, I'm not feeling comfortable with this. Can mm-hmm. you please address this issue? I mean, often it takes a lot of courage and effort to only be true to yourself and be true to other people, let alone, go ahead and do that and complain and say, I'm being hostile, treating in a hostile manner. Mm-hmm. And that's about it. But something that really interesting to me, which you mentioned, like, you mentioned the cutting edge will not stand for this kind of behavior, right? Has Cutting Edge done anything recently to reprimand or to correct the situation in any manner other than, firing? Well, I'm not saying that firing her is a way to correct it, but we're curious on how Cutting Edge is approaching the matter, because that's obviously a very important matter for us.
We've had a couple of previous, like, workplace issues that have come up that we've settled. From the information that I have.
What kind of previous issues do you mean?
Sexual harassment.
Oh, sexual harassment.
Like, in the workplace, a couple that are previous. I don't have too much information on the exact details, apart from one of them was very frivolous, and we settled it for a very minor, it's confidential, I can't say the exact sum, but very minor sum. And, just to avoid kind of, the complexities and whatnot that comes from the litigation.
Okay. How many issues? Two or one, you say?
From what I'm aware of, two.
Two. Because I have information, and please correct me if I'm wrong, of course, that, speaking of minor sums, that there was another settlement with Cutting Edge on a discrimination case.
Yes.
That was settled for quite a large sum. I'm not saying that, that this is what I want.
Yeah.
But obviously, like, when you say minor sums.
So there was, one of them was a frivolous claim, and then there's the other one where an employee who was engaging in discrimination, and he was fired, and then we settled for and then we settled for the plaintiff, or rather the plaintiff received 1 year salary.
So you settled with the employee who was discriminated.
So there are two separate ones. There's one that was frivolous that we settled for a minor sum.
Uh-huh.
And then there's another one where we settled with the plaintiff.
But just to be
Or rather, the plaintiff received 1 year salary.
Okay. No, I'm just curious as to who the plaintiff is. The plaintiff is the person who was fired because he was engaging in discriminatory conduct?
No, the person I was firing was the perpetrator. The individual
that was
doing the discrimination.
Okay, yeah.
One person.
So that was the one who received a settlement.
No. The plaintiff did. The person, the victim, received
the
settlement for 1 year's salary.
Oh, and then you fired the perpetrator.
And we fired the perpetrator.
Okay.
And then there was the other one I was discussing as well, which was the minor sum, a settlement for a minor sum.
Okay.
Which the company said that it was frivolous. And then it was, so it was these two. That's
just
the information that
sorry,
I
just want to make sure. To make sure this is still recording. Sorry for interrupting.
I think it is.
Okay.
Right, yeah.
Sorry for interrupting there.
Oh, no worries. So that's, that's the information I have in regards to the pest
so
issues.
You're obviously, I don't want to say, maybe keen to settlement. I mean, obviously, no one wants to go to litigation.
Absolutely.
And spend a lot of time. So, would it be safe to say that you're inclined to reach a settlement? Of course, right?
Absolutely. You know, we're very hopeful, and you know, we're confident that both of us will be able to reach a settlement. As I mentioned before, you know, this type of the conduct that you discussed is not okay. And, you know, for someone to express themselves in the workplace when that is not, when that's something that's different, you know, in compared to, you know, the other employees that we have, that's, you know, something that's courageous. Uh-huh. And that's not okay. So, you know, we would be very much, you know, keen to settle, you know, so we could avoid, you know, having litigation. Because, you know, from our end, you know, of course, there are many costs. And, you know, and also, like, we'd like to, you know, put this matter, you know, be behind us. And then, you know, I'm sure, you know, Chris, would like to as well, you know, given them with some of the things you've indicated.
Yeah, sure. And, we are inclined to reach a settlement as well, provided that we can reach an agreement. And I would like to hear about a little bit more about where cutting edges coming across, like you mentioned earlier, you were interested in knowing how we were coming across, what was our perspective.
Yeah.
So we'll be a little more interested in, you know, hearing about how is Cutting Edge reacting to all of this.
Yeah, so, there's been a little bit of, Cutting Edge is in a moment of sort of like transition as a company.
Mm-hmm.
And, there has been and there will be a little bit of turnover.
What do you mean transition, though?
Transition. Well, there's turnover. You know, with employees. Our CEO who's been there for a long time. He's trying to transition a company. You know, trying to have the company grow and become a better, stronger company.
Okay.
Financially and you just as a business, we have pretty excited about. We have a new group. That is in control of the company. So we have, quite a few new board members. So, and, so we've just been trying to, pretty much transition as a company. We've had, the CEO expressed, this to me. We've had a, let go of, some people as we've been sort of transforming as a company. And his contention is.
Have you let go of many people?
I don't believe I have the information right now. Most of what I do have is, from our CEO that he says that Chris was fired as a result of weak performance. So definitely Chris. It was someone that was let go. And also that our board is pretty much like analyzing, taking a close look at, the efficiency of, all the workers, because there's going to be a little bit of, that turnover.
Okay. Yeah. Who made the decision to fire Chris, if I'm okay to ask?
Based on the information I have, I'm not 100% certain, but I believe it was Sal, the CEO, because he discussed, some of the reasons why Chris was fired. So as a result, I'm assuming, I'm not 100% sure, that he, at the very least, he was very, he was somewhat involved in the decision, but I believe that it was under his authority as CEO.
No, yep, that's okay. That's okay. I mean, of course, it's under his authority.
Right.
I'm just concerned about, I mean, how it comes across in a way.
Okay.
I mean,
yeah.
Obviously, you said the CEO has been in the company for a very long time. Same as Chris, who's been in the company from the start, basically. He's done a lot for the company. And now you're telling me that they're trying to make the company better, like a bigger and stronger financial company, and to transition in a better business structure. And it would seem logical that Chris should be a key part of, in all of this, but rather she was let go. And, you know, there were some concerns about as to the reasons as why she was let go. Do you know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah, so the information, what I have is she was let go as a result of weak performance. You know, Sal told me, the information I have is that, you know, she was, her performance had recently been dropping. She for a very long time, she has been a very productive, you know, and a key part of the team. But recently, you know, her performance, you know, has been dropping quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she seemed, at least according to Sal, you know, she seemed, you know, a bit tired. We're not sure if this was a result of, you know, the change in hours or some other circumstances that might have come up. But, she just didn't seem to be as energetic.
Okay.
She just doesn't seem to be there, like, on a day-to-day basis, you know, according to Sal, our CEO.
Yeah, I understand correctly. Yeah. And so, basically, you're saying that she lacked energy and she lacked commitment and she was tired or her work, like, her performance dropped, mm-hmm. and she just wasn't there as much time, right?
Yeah, that's what I have.
And just to you know, discuss this, do you think it occurred to Sal that maybe this was a reason of, you know, the fact that she was being treated in a hostile manner, and like the drop in hours could be the result of she not wanting to be there so much because she was being treated badly? And then maybe she was tired because she was sleep deprived because she was suffering within of this like hostility at her own place. I mean, I think I'm not saying what your CEO should do or should not do.
Yeah, absolutely.
But I'm just thinking, like, if I were in that position and I knew a person that had worked with me for 16 years and had done so much for the company, and she all of a sudden started changing her performance, I would at least try to approach her at least once and say, you know, hey, is everything okay? Is there something going on? Like, I'm concerned about your performance, rather than just, you know, go ahead and fire her at once.
Yeah.
And again, my concern is how that comes across. I mean,
absolutely.
Like, all of these facts put together certainly make it dubious as to the company reasons for firing Chris. You know what I...
Yeah, absolutely. So what are, I'd be interested, from your perspective, Ben, you know, I think that's, you know, very, you know, valid, and, you know, thank you for that. I was thinking, what are some of the things that, you know, from your perspective and your client's perspective, that the client could have, you know, done, things that we could have, the company, rather, could have done, you know, differently to make Chris not only feel like a, continue like a valid, if that's, she wasn't feeling like a valid member of the team, not only make her feel like a valid member of the team, you know, but also try to, you know, address some, you know, some of the concerns or get at, you know, sort of some of the concerns. I'd be interested to, you know, hear some of that from you.
Yeah, I mean, sure. For one, I think that acting on the issues against the perpetrators and, you know, taking disciplinary measures, I'm not sure how the internal code of conduct of the company is, but I'm sure they have some certain disciplinary measures for, undo work behavior, and that for one could have been a step forward. Also, you know, maybe reaching out to Chris and saying, you know, hey, it's gonna be okay. Do you need some time off to, you know, pull yourself together, or do you maybe want to transfer to another area where you don't have to work with these people? Or I don't know. There are many ways. Like, for example, say that she was part of a team And especially she was part of a team in which out of 16 or 15 people, she was the only girl. And the rest were all guys. And I'm not saying I'm not gonna condone this behavior, but we're both men, and we understand that men tend to be pretty rude sometimes. And it's not that they're mean, but it's just the way they act. I mean, we just normally just don't think before we act in many cases. So maybe an option could be, you know, you can distance yourself from this group who seems to be pretty hostile to you. Maybe you can come work directly with me on some other new projects, for example. Or, you know, you can work with the CEO developing this new project, and you can work one-on-one and maybe, you know, start a new project and develop your own team. You know, whatever. I mean, I think there are several types of solutions.
Yeah, thank you.
But essentially, any action on the company's behalf would have been good, which Chris felt that none was taken.
Okay. Yeah, thank you very much for that. That's very helpful. You mentioned a little bit about kind of like the workplace atmosphere in there. Yeah, I had a couple of questions on that. So how would, so in the workplace, you know, Chris was there for 16 years, a long time. Would she characterize the workplace as one where, you know, a lot of people were teasing each other, the employees, and there's a lot of teasing and joking around?
She hadn't mentioned anything to me about, like, that there was teasing at any moment. She did mention to me that she did love working there, and she did put a lot of effort into it, that she was really proud of working there, and after she came out and made her decision public, she started, you know, being treated in a hostile manner. And that's pretty much it. She did not mention that.
Okay.
It was a common thing to, you know, be like a teasing around the company with coworkers.
Was she like particularly close with anyone?
Sorry, I did not have that information.
Did she give you any other information? Because you mentioned that she was like very happy, you know, in the company. Did she give you information like following up on that? Like, what are some of the things that she particularly enjoyed, for instance, about the company or working at the company?
Let me just check.
Absolutely.
I can tell you that one thing that she for certainly was proud was that she had been working there for such a long time.
Right.
She worked her way up. And obviously, like I said, for someone who has been the first one to graduate college in their family.
That's amazing.
I mean, it's certainly a big achievement.
Absolutely.
And that alone, I think that gives her a sense of entitlement, you know, a part of the sense of belonging in the company, saying, you know, hey, I built something. And, well, yeah, that's it. I mean, she was actually just very, very upset and focused mainly during our prior meetings on, you know, the discrimination and harassment issues.
Do you mentioned that she was, you know, the first to graduate, you know, from college and in her family, and, you know, so that's a great achievement, you know, first and foremost, I want to say. And is this something that ever came up, you know, in the workplace?
I have no information.
In terms of her not feeling comfortable because she felt like it was a different environment, perhaps that her family came from or anything?
I have no information on that.
I want to ask a little bit about, you know, her work schedule. So I have some information that her work schedule had changed, and that actually that's what, if I recall correctly, that's what Sal sort of pointed to in regards to a possible reason why her performance dropped. What I have is she adopted a child.
Yeah.
And then she had is that correct? And she had to change her work schedule to kind of, you know, accommodate, you know, for those responsibilities, right?
Well, let me just check something real quick.
Mm-hmm.
I want to make sure, because I'm not sure if it was, like, an official change in the schedule, though.
Okay.
Like, obviously, when you have a kid.
Yeah.
You have to adjust your schedule in some sort of way. But it's something that pretty much everyone goes through at some point. and everyone bounces back from that. I'm pretty sure there was not a formal change in schedule saying, hey, I'm gonna start working, you know, from now on, I'm gonna take the mornings off or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, at some points, I'm not saying this is true, mm-hmm. but it wouldn't be surprising if sometimes, you know, she would take an hour off, you know, maybe to, you know, go pick up her baby from the babysitter or something or other. I mean, that's pretty common in every workplace. Okay. But even so, like in these types of companies, you know, tech companies, like in my experience, they're not so tough or strict on work time, on like FaceTime
mm-hmm.
and hours, rather on their more objective and target focused.
Mm-hmm.
Like I've advised some other clients in the tech business as well before, and you know, in most cases they just work from home, or they showed up to the company when they needed to, or
right.
it was kind of like, you know, it's a more laid back environment. It's not us that we're lawyers that we have to be in the office at some point.
So,
and if you leave at any time before 9, they probably shoot you or something.
So you know, so after she you know, she adopted a child. Was she unable to, you know, to work at night, you know, as much as before? Did she have to kind of like change
it? I wouldn't say if she was not able to work at night.
But was it more difficult, would you say, for her to, you know, like work from home or come in late at work, you know, if there's a project that needs to be completed or whatnot?
I mean, it certainly can be difficult with any baby.
Right.
But I think it's a factual situation. I mean, I'm not sure if it, like, on a general basis, it was whether more difficult or not.
Okay.
I mean, you would, in many cases, if you have to come work at night, you can say to your spouse, you know, can you take care of the baby tonight? Yes, no, okay, then I will figure out, we'll call a babysitter. I mean, there's lots of logistics around, you know, having a baby. But I'm not sure, or at least I wouldn't say, or I have any, you know, strong information as to whether her performance had changed drastically because of the baby.
Yeah.
I mean, other than any other person in the company would have had like a hard time, you know, having a baby.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see how it was different in Chris's case.
Right. Okay. And then, by the way, this is just my curiosity. How old is how's the baby?
I think it's about 1 year old or so. You can see they adopted a baby in
1 year.
Yeah,
the boy or girl?
It's a girl.
Oh, that's amazing. Yeah, how's that transition been? I'm sure. Is she a first time parent?
Yeah, she's a first time.
Okay, so has it been you know, transition, you know, being a first time parent, like significant or just?
I guess so. I mean,
yeah.
It's.
I can't imagine. I don't have any kids, so.
Yeah, me either, but.
Right,
it's always certainly it's a transition, but I'm guessing it's a great time, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's pretty exciting. Yeah, and then nothing that we kind of touched on, and I just want to go a little more detail was how are we doing?
No, we're good.
Okay. Is are the you know, performance reviews? So yeah, at first I just want to start like how often did Chris have performance reviews with her managers, supervisor.
I don't have that information. Sorry.
Do you have any information on the performance
review? Performance review? No, I don't have any information for performance review.
Okay. And then, just in general, did anyone? So from our company's perspective, you know, or at least what they told me is her, you know, her work, you know, time, her workplace, production went down in. You know, she seemed tired and whatnot. And so with that being said, like, are you aware of any time that cutting edge, you know, talked to her about this, about her performance?
No, I'm not aware of that. Like, the what she said is that she had been having a hard time with, you know, with the discrimination issues.
Okay.
And then out of the blue, she was just basically fired. And, you know, that's pretty much it.
Okay, so you don't have anything on like possible like action plans that they gave us
to improve her performance? No.
Yeah. Okay.
I don't have. Do you have those?
No, I don't. I just have very general information. So that's what I was just trying to follow up.
No. That's pretty much it.
And you sort of mentioned, we discussed this briefly when we were talking about the workplace, and you mentioned that workplace predominantly men. So yeah, I just wanted to follow up on that. Has Chris said anything about diversity or the lack thereof in the workplace?
No, she hasn't mentioned anything about diversity or lack of diversity in the workplace. I mean, though she is a big part of the company in the sense that she had worked a lot.
Right.
I mean, she is, she's still just a software development manager, and that kind of issue just is outside her scope of competence.
Okay.
You know.
And is Chris working now?
No, she's currently unemployed.
Okay. And then I'm sure with the baby too, that's more than a full-time job.
Yeah.
And then is she searching for a job, or is she just focusing on?
No, she's searching for a job.
Oh, she's looking.
Yes, she's looking for a job. I mean, usually you have to support a baby.
Right. Absolutely.
You need to have a job. Yeah.
And how's your job search looking?
It's going. It's. I don't know. Seems kind of. I wouldn't say tough, but obviously it's hard for to just jump back out and right into another job. I mean, it's gonna take some time, obviously.
Yeah. Exactly. Does she What type of work is she looking for? Like, what type of job?
Well. She's trying to do the same, pretty much a similar industry as she was doing Cutting Edge. She might be also interested in working, freelance, consulting for other companies. In freelance, it's obviously could include Cutting Edge as well. That's pretty much how it goes.
Okay. Do you have any more information on your interest in perhaps doing some freelance or consulting work?
No, that's pretty much it.
Okay.
I mean, she's just looking to...
Yeah, I think that's absolutely something we could discuss. And are there any other interests or, concerns that, that Chris has that really haven't come up yet? Anything I'm missing?
Well, let me think. Just to summarize, I think this actually could be really useful for negotiations. Would you be willing to do a summary of the interests of yours once well? I can tell you right off. I mean, obviously, she wants to settle this issue. I mean, she doesn't want to drag out litigation.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, she wants to work again.
Yeah. So absolutely.
She wants to. She wants to safeguard her reputation.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty much it. I mean, and she's obviously also interested in preventing this from happening to someone else in the future. So she would really like to see Cutting Edge, take some action in this regard. Like I said, she's open to working at another company in a similar job, or maybe do some freelance consulting to other companies. Obviously, not less important, she needs to receive money. I mean,
absolutely.
So that she can support herself. I mean, she received the money that she would have been earned in this time if she hadn't been unduly fired.
Mm-hmm.
The setup, the claims I've made, I'm sure you're aware of them,
right?
And that's pretty much it. How about for Cutting Edge?
Yeah, from our perspective, there's various reasons as well why we want to settle. First, of course, we would prefer, if possible, to avoid the litigation.
Uh-huh.
And to move forward from this. We want to I mentioned that there is a little bit the company is a little bit in flux. you know, in regards, you know, to changes. So we want to sort of, you know, focus on that, see what direction that, you know, the company is going to take, you know, going from here. We're also you know, interested in, you know, safeguarding the reputation of the company. You know, we have a long-standing relationship, and you know, as Chris mentioned, this is a pretty, you know, it's a very good place, you know, to work in, and we want to continue to have, you know, that reputation, you know, of good, you know, good place to work in, and then of course we'd be interested in releasing claims. You know, this is along to the point, just, you know, moving forward, you know, from this, you know, to you know, perhaps, you know, to end this, not have litigation, not have any other claims.
Yeah, because it really looks, I mean, I think litigation just looks bad.
Absolutely, completely agree.
I mean, obviously, Chris doesn't want to come up as an employee who sues her employer, because, I mean, despite many laws that we have to protect people, mm-hmm. I mean, companies just don't like that. I mean,
exactly.
And obviously, for a company cutting edge, which exactly the name cutting edge, would not be reflecting the company policy of, you know, condoning discriminatory practices mm-hmm. in the workplace. Mm-hmm. So publicity for cutting edge is also not very good in this case. I agree. So we really don't want to have this into litigation, especially in the Supreme Court.
Yeah,
so, you know, I agree with you.
Yeah, and you know, I wanted to point out as well, like, another interest of ours is we do have a long-standing relationship with Chris, and we want to make sure that relationship that we have, you know, that a lot of us, I'm sure, know her at a very personal level. You know, we do want to have a good relationship, you know, with her moving forward, rather than have, you know, things end in, you know, with this, you know, in these type of circumstances. So that's something that I'm sure, you know, something we could bounce forward ideas and whatnot in regards to what exactly it's going to look like. But yeah, I think that, you know, we do have a lot of, you know, we're both looking for many of the same things, and I do think that we have, you know, quite a bit of room to find an agreement that's going to, you know, satisfy, you know, both of our interests and concerns.
Okay.
So I was wondering, let's see how we're doing real quickly. Okay. I was wondering if...
Do you want to maybe discuss some possible appearance now?
Yeah, or...
You know what it was? Oh, sorry. Just go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say, like I mentioned this earlier, did you want to just bounce forward with as many ideas as possible?
Exactly. I was
and we get yeah, just
thing.
Draw upon them, just anything we could think of in terms of things that could be included.
Yeah, I completely agree. That's actually what I wanted to do as well.
No, perfect.
Okay, so, so you mentioned that you have a long-standing relationship with Chris, and I. Correct me if I'm wrong, but mm-hmm. I seem to have picked up that you have some interest in working with her freelance still, right? Or do you not? Is that a
no? Right? I think that's a possibility. I think that you know, something that we could discuss.
So freelance is also one of the things.
Yeah, some freelance consulting work.
Also, another issue. Reputational wise, like could help us both.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, I mean, having her fired, like you saying that you fired this employee would force you to, you know, maybe disclose or at least, you know, have some concerns about what were the reasons why you fired her. Like, I mean, some people would wonder. And obviously, for Chris, she doesn't want to look at someone who's been fired.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe, you know, change the terms of the termination of employment, like not having her register as like an fired employee, and, you know, I suppose maybe having a letter of recommendation or so, you know, mm-hmm. that'd be possible.
Let's add that, and then we could sort of discuss how that play out. Yeah, let's just add everything. Yeah. So let me get that straight. Wait, were you saying two different? So you're saying just Can you recap that one more time?
Okay.
I just want to make sure I understood correctly.
Basically, she doesn't want to be listed as an employee who has been fired.
Okay.
She would rather have provided with a settlement, letter of recommendation, so that she could find another job.
Oh, okay. So pretty much just provide letters of recommendation.
Yeah.
And then include language that doesn't say.
Yeah, that's since
that doesn't say that she's fired. Say she's working here.
For it's like a mutual termination or something.
Yeah, yeah, we could, I think that's something as well we could discuss. Absolutely.
You got any ideas?
Yeah, so I was thinking, along those lines, you know, our concerns with your reputation of non-disclosure agreement, would that be all right?
Yeah.
Or a possibility?
Certainly doable.
Yeah. You know, obviously, like, this is recent claims. If we were to
what?
Release of claims.
Yeah.
You know, if we were to
We're gonna reach a settlement.
Yeah, course. Exactly. You know, you mentioned freelance. We have that letter of recommendation. If I'm understanding correctly, you know, a lot of the concern is how from Chris's end, how she didn't necessarily feel comfortable or like welcomed at a certain point. Would some sort of like thank you letter for her service, you know, at the company, you know, something recognizing her service, would you think that would be something she'd be interested in?
I mean, considering it would be useful, but I don't see adding too much value.
Okay.
I mean, like, I think the recommendation letter alone would provide, I mean,
that's what she's, okay,
would take implicit that issue. She would much rather see discipline action on the, you know, the perpetrators rather than having a thank you letter, I think.
Okay.
That would say more thank you, you know, saying they took care of the issue rather than saying, you know, thank you for your service, but we're still going to keep perpetrators on board so they can keep doing it.
Okay. So with the disciplinary action, again, we could discuss it, and I think this might go beyond my authority, but it's something I could discuss with my superiors, and it could be included in an agreement to discuss this. Maybe, you know, taking a look at anti-discrimination policy.
Okay.
You know, at the company, seeing what we could do there, or just taking a look at, yeah, exactly, doing analysis on the workplace.
Uh-huh.
Would that be something that helped?
Yeah, I'm sure you can take that back and we can discuss this further.
Yeah, exactly. That's something you can discuss further. It's not clear that's in the scope of my authority.
Uh-huh.
But of course, there's something as a part of the agreement I could take back to the CEO and discuss it with him. I think that's all. I don't know. Is there anything else you had? I could perhaps discuss.
Let me see. Other than money?
Yeah, and then, yeah, of course, the elephant.
I think that's pretty much the main issue. I think. And also that we want to avoid litigation, but that's obviously
right now, right?
So yeah, that's it. And wasn't it? We want money. So let's just go over the claims that were filed.
Okay.
So that we can maybe start working from there.
Okay.
So here's what I have. Let me just print this in two sided. Okay, here it is. So the claim was originally 175K in back pay for salaries that she hasn't received because she was fired. Then 150K in 1 year front pay.
Okay.
And 350K for emotional distress for the pain she had suffered, which gives us a total of $575,000.
Yeah, I have that as well.
Obviously, I'm not going to force you right now, so you take it or leave it, because
mm-hmm.
that's not why we're here.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think that's a good starting point.
Okay. Okay, perfect, yeah. So, I think, sort of, you know, as the other end of it, based on how we've handled this. So, you know, as I mentioned earlier, I have information on two previous, you know, payments to employees on claims of discrimination.
Mm-hmm.
There was one, you know, the one that I discussed before that was frivolous was a very minor sum. So I let's not even.
Okay.
Yeah, let's not even waste time. Let's talk about the other one. Yeah. The other one is.
Do you have any of the facts of that case? Maybe comparable to this one.
What I have is a egregious sexual harassment. So it was pretty bad.
What was the?
That was the highest we've ever paid before.
But what was like the act that they did? You know.
That's all I have. Okay. Yeah, it was just characterized as egregious sexual harassment. That's the most we have ever paid.
Uh-huh.
And then the plaintiff that in that situation received 1 year salary.
Which was how much?
The plaintiff's 1 year salary was
$300K.
Yeah, but it was linked. The language there, it was linked to the salary.
Okay.
So what we're thinking coming in, her 1 year salary was 125,000. So we're thinking, I guess as the counterpoint, hitting about 125,000.
Yeah, that's gonna be a little bit low for us.
Oh yeah, I mean we could. You know, that's a starting point. We could work and see. I can't go a lot higher than 125 because then I'll hit you to the point where I probably won't have the authority to make the deal. But
okay.
But I think we do have room. We have a little bit of room.
Just go as high as you can until your authority and then.
Well, it's not as simple because. There's quite a few other things as well that we could work on. But yeah, let's just start. So you started with 275. Okay.
Yeah.
And let's just start. Ours 125, and
okay. So the back pay, I mean, you're saying the 1 year salary, you say, right? So basically what you're saying that you'd be willing to pay as it is right now. Well, I'm not sure though. I mean, why is 125K? 125 is like her yearly salary, right?
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm getting at. Okay, so all right, the most we have ever paid someone is 1 year salary. From the information I have, the way we, the policy seems to be when, at least in these two cases, is you like the most you'll pay is that person 1 year salary. Mm-hmm. It's linked to their salary, at least in that most egregious case. So then that's why I was getting $125,000 because that's how much she was paid at that time.
So you were basically concerned about setting a precedent for future cases.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Okay, but that's an issue. I think that we can address or sort of safeguard against the non-disclosure agreement.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. I mean, and it's also, I mean, obviously, as future precedent, it's also, like, we only have a certain amount of money that, you know, we could get. I mean, that's the obvious point, though. But,
okay.
Because the 575, I mean, it's obvious point, but it's way past. I mean, of course, I know that was just opening.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's quite a ways away.
I understand.
No, yeah, we'll get there.
So just to see if I understand it correctly, one of the issues that you're concerned about is the precedent.
Yeah, which absolutely.
Obviously something what we want to address with non-disclosure. And the other issue is obviously your budget. I mean, there is only a certain amount of money that you can allocate to this, right? Regardless of the way the name we put to the money, I mean, we can call it back pay, front pay, emotional distress, or party money.
Mm-hmm.
No one's gonna know because you said beyond the non-disclosure. But you're apparently incapacity of paying an amount close to 300K because you have done it before, right?
Well, that was before. Yeah, that's when we cannot pay 300.
You cannot pay
300. No, we cannot pay 300. I can't tell you. It's confidential. I can't tell you the exact amount that we can, but it's definitely not 300. Yeah, that exceeds the authority that I have.
Okay, that's, I understand.
Yeah. But
I'm going to have to ask you to come up with a better offer than 125K.
Yeah, okay. All right, so let's do it. Out of the possibilities that we discussed previously, let's start off with, apart from money, obviously, what is the one that you know, Chris feels most strongly about, is most interested in?
Apart from money.
Yeah.
I would say your main interests are tied to either the disciplinary action on one hand,
mm-hmm.
and the recommendation letter, because that is obviously ties her to, you know, getting a job back. And that also goes hand in hand with their freelance option.
Okay, so this, the disciplinary action?
Yeah, and then
and the freelance?
And the recommendation letter.
Oh, I'm sorry, the recommendation letter.
And the freelance, goes hand in hand.
Okay.
Because, like, her interest is not to have one or the other. Her interest is, you know, to, you know, have a work and be financially stable and be able to support her family.
Mm-hmm.
So those two together, they obviously affect that interest,
mm-hmm.
whether together or separate.
Okay. You know, we could, the letter recommendation, I think, is something that we could do pretty easily. Who was Chris's supervisor, direct supervisor, Rossell? Do you have that information?
I think so, but I don't have a confirmed, like, 100% information.
Yeah. I don't have any information on Sal would react to the letter recommendation,
uh-huh.
but I don't see it being a problem. I could include it just like contingent on,
okay,
and Sal's approval. I don't see it being a problem, but
okay, that's
so. Would that be fine?
Yeah, that would be fine,
yeah.
But I mean,
But
let me just,
yeah,
put this clear. I don't mean to be aggressive.
No, go ahead.
But I mean, the recommendation letter, considering all that has happened, it's pretty much one of the least things that the company can do.
Yeah, absolutely. No, that exactly. That's what I'm turning to.
So I'm not saying that we can replace, like, a large sum of money or recommendation letter, which is basically gonna cost the company zero money and something they can easily do, and
yeah.
It's pretty much the least they can do. Especially if it's gonna be contingent.
Yeah.
So what I guess I'm trying to say is, I don't see that as replacing a large sum of money.
Right. Yeah, I just think it depends.
It certainly will be easier to reach a deal if that is in the table.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely. I just think that, yeah, all right, to be completely frank, yeah, the letter recommendation isn't mentioned at all here.
Uh-huh.
That's why, so, like, having someone write something, I'm just being, like, extremely cautious for mine.
Okay, yeah,
but that being said, I think there won't be a problem with, like, writing a recommendation letter that, you know, discusses basics, such as some of the projects that, you know, just factual stuff, like some of the projects that, you know, Chris has been a part of, you know, the length of time, and you know, some of the good things that Chris has done for the company.
Yeah.
And just mentioning that, and mentioning Chris's experiences.
Yeah.
I don't think that'll be a problem at all.
Mentioning Chris's experience and like the contribution that she has made to the company.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So let's put that on the table.
Let's do, like, I'm doing like a mixed list. So we're putting the recommendation letter.
Yeah. Let's.
So I'll put this 1, 2, 3, 4. So we got one.
Mm-hmm.
Then obviously I am assuming that you're gonna want the non-disclosure, right?
Of course, yeah. And release of claims as well.
Yeah. So 3 plus 4. Sorry, I'm just numbering the issues.
No, that's
that
helps.
So we got that. But we're still, I mean, obviously these things can be done. I mean, I don't see a problem with this.
Okay,
but we need to, you know, reach a better agreement on the money, though. Like, I mean, 125K in itself is not gonna cut it.
All right, wait, just these two things, could we do 200? That's getting close for me, but I think we could work with 200.
You know, I appreciate that you're trying to get close,
mm-hmm.
but we still need to go a little bit higher. Would you be willing to go 275?
No, I can't.
No.
200 is extreme. Yeah, I can't. That's blown.
You can absolutely go 275.
Like, especially with these things, like we're a bit of ways away.
Okay. How about we throw the freelance into the mix? Do you have any authority on that?
Yes. If we throw freelancing to the lit mix,
yeah,
could we work with 200?
Maybe, yeah.
Okay.
Maybe, because that would help, bro, you know, support yourself.
Yeah, let's throw that to the mix.
And what would you say, some kind of action for freelance? Do you have any ideas? Or is it just like a commitment to work freelancing? Because obviously, I mean, if it's going to be a commitment to work freelance for 2 months for hourly rate of $5 an hour, it's not going to work. So obviously we need something a little bit more clear.
Okay. So are you interested in learning more about like exactly if like what type of freelancing work you would do or like how much money, how long?
I don't want to intrude into what type of freelancing she would
okay,
do.
Okay, okay,
they should know what type of work they're gonna do. But mostly, I would be interested in the amount of time, the amount of money, and the amount of hours that she's gonna be putting in.
Yeah. Okay. So then, I think the in regards to the amount of time, amount of hours, because it's going to depend on how much, we end up like paying and how the payment structure, ends up being and the amount. Because let's say if the freelance work is part of the 200, then, we could be more flexible in how much time she could be doing that for.
Okay.
You
mean how much time in
How much we could pay her for the freelance. But that's if it's part of the 200. You know what I mean? And then let's say if you're not including that on the 200 thousand, and then we cannot give her that much freelance and consulting work, because that's still going to be, we're still going to look at it as part of like the overall settlement, I guess, if you think of it like that, because then we still won't have that in our budget.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's not good. All right. I'm trying to think of.
So if it's not within the settlement, you cannot do as much freelance as if you put it within the settlement.
Okay, so I'm thinking of this whatever agreement we reached in terms of money.
Mm-hmm.
The way I was thinking about it to help me is even if she does consulting work, include whatever the consulting work, like the money she is she's gonna be paid for consulting work. Include that just like in your head or in my head, I'm including it as like part of like whatever the amount we come up with. And then I was just trying to make the point where if what we're discussing is 200,000 payment for settlement, and on top of that she'll be paid separately for the consulting freelance work, then we won't be able to pay her that much for that consulting freelance work just because we're already the 200,000 is like already it's a pretty high amount for us of what we could pay. If we're including that as a part of the 200,000, then I think we have some room to work and especially if, does she have any preference on how she is paid this?
Upfront.
Well, in terms of tax implications.
Oh yeah. Yeah. It's certainly another issue that we have to discuss. We would rather, I'm certainly you're familiar with the WD and 1099.
Yeah.
Terms, right?
Yeah.
So we would rather do a 1099 than a W2 for tax purposes, especially if she's working freelance and consulting, which is obviously, fits a little bit more into that category than W2. Or maybe we can, do a split in which any amount of, we split an amount of settlement that goes into W2, if that's really important for you guys, and the amount that's gonna be on freelance and consulting goes on 1099. I mean, just spitballing options here. Okay. Thing is, we need to have a cap. I mean, because if you say 200 is the amount of the settlement, and then she ends up working a lot of time, then she has still been like just out for work and she hasn't received a settlement. I mean, let's put it another way. Yeah. So you're a lawyer. Mm-hmm. Well, of course we're lawyers. Mm-hmm. And you're charging, I don't know, $250 an hour. And $250 an hour for 10 hours are $25,000.
Mm-hmm.
And so you say, okay, your settlement's gonna be $125 plus a 10-hour freelance. Also, we're gonna pay you a bulk of $150.
Mm-hmm.
But in reality, you don't end up working 10 hours, but you end up working 20 hours. So really, your settlement was $100,000, and your consulting was $50,000.
Mm-hmm.
So you should have been paid $175,000 rather than $150,000. Do you know what I'm trying to say here? Do you understand? I'm confusing.
So then it seems like she's concerned where she's going to get, like, all right, you're going to end up being paid like $10,000, let's just say, for consulting.
I'm
work
saying,
over X amount of hours, it's going to take longer than the hours are supposed to.
Yeah, I'm saying, like,
is that it?
If we pay her $200,000,
mm-hmm.
but we make her work for this $200,000, it's not a settlement. It's not a compensation. So.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
I mean,
that's what you're saying.
We're
yeah.
still juicing her out for her work.
Yeah.
So she might as well just, you know, just work on any other company
yeah.
and get paid that $200,000.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
And
okay,
then
I got you.
Receive a settlement.
Yeah. I was just thinking like a part of it.
Yeah.
Like, a fraction of it. Like I wasn't thinking like everything. Not even, you know, by any means.
Okay. So you let me say if I understand you correctly. So you're a part of it. So maybe like. Say 50% of a settlement goes to freelance and then you pay an extra 50% outside of the settlement. Is that what you're saying?
Wait, say it one more time.
So you're saying just a part of it goes mm-hmm. into the settlement? So if you say that, for example, I don't know, the freelance is gonna cost $50,000, you know,
mm-hmm.
just to give it a number.
Mm-hmm.
So $25,000 of those $50,000 goes into the $200 settlement, and then out of pocket of the company you pay an extra $25,000. Or, you know, freelance, just regular freelance.
Oh, okay.
Is that
I was just thinking.
I understood
yeah.
that.
I was just thinking. Like, have a deal with the overall money, how much she is going to be paid, and
okay.
just that figure, and then within that figure, and then just carve out a small part. That okay? This is gonna be, you know, for some consulting work.
Okay.
Just to make it a little bit easier, like in terms of like how we kind of like categorize it. That's the way I was. Sort of. So let's just say we're like talking about.
Uh-huh.
Wait. Before I just to take a step back, does Chris have a preference for how much or how long?
She
wants to work as a consultant.
No, she doesn't work. Well,
I mean,
Maybe she does. I mean, I'm pretty
yeah.
sure she does.
Yeah, because I'm not sure if she wanted something that is a little bit longer term for, you know, for money because. I'm thinking it might help her, like, as she's applying for jobs, you know, that could,
yeah.
she could put that as a current position. Or I don't know if she wanted to, you know, she's a little bit more limited in time.
Certainly, like, at least a year would be, like, the minimum mm-hmm. that we want to work freelance.
At least a year? Okay.
Yeah. And, yeah. Yeah, I would say at least a year. I mean, obviously, we could do more. That would be great.
Okay.
Because you know, obviously, something that would be awesome for her is
mm-hmm.
if she could do freelance. You know, at least until her kid is in, like,
yeah.
you know,
I don't
elementary
have,
school.
Yeah.
Then. That'd be great. So
I don't believe I have any limitation. In terms of for how long, so I think a year would work. I do have limitations, like how much money as a part of an agreement it could be in regards, you know, the consulting could be.
Do you have like a limit in terms of percentage or in terms of like actual money?
In terms of actual money, like for consulting, we cannot go over $50,000 as a part of the settlement. Like
for
like,
freelance.
Yeah. So let's say let's just say if we were to agree to like $200,000 agreement. Only $50,000 of that $200,000.
What can you do to 50?
I can't. Yeah.
No.
Not
at all. Because we, what I seem to understand, like, of course, like
250
you
is
willing to, no, yeah. sorry, no, you're willing to offer 200,000, and mm-hmm. then you ask about the possibility of working freelance, and you're saying like you're willing to go up to 50,000 working freelance.
Oh yeah,
so
I was
assuming that the 200,000 was without the freelance possibility.
No, like, yeah, that's what I've been saying. I've been trying. I've been thinking about this as an overall package.
Uh-huh.
You like in the pot of 200,000, there might be there will be some freelance work.
Okay.
There will be, and then some of the other things we could also do. You know, but in regards to the freelance work, we don't really have any strong. I don't have any information, any strong preference for how much. If she wants to do, you know, a little bit less, I think we can work with that freelance. Yeah, I was just thinking that, especially since, you know, Chris is, you know, looking for something right now. I just thought that could sort of, you know, help in that regard and just, you know, help her make a little bit of money, you know, while she's looking for something that's more permanent.
The thing is, like, if you're willing to go up to 50,000 on freelance, I mean, I don't see that going further than a year because, well, you're not gonna live off 50,000 for 2 or 3 years, obviously. I mean, if your salary was 125,
mm-hmm.
I mean, that pretty much makes up for less than half of, you know, her yearly expenses, assuming that she lives solely on her salary.
But I think the perspective we're coming from is on top of that 50, she's getting the 150,000.
Yeah.
So for 200, so.
Can you do better than 200? Mr. Owen?
With some of the parts of the, like, with the letter of recommendation, some of the parts of the agreement that we have, you know, I think that 200 is what we're looking at. Unless, if you, yeah, it's going to be really hard to go over. And then with the consulting stuff.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let me just make some calculations on the reservation value to see whether that would indeed
fit
my. Okay, I'm gonna be completely straightforward with you.
Okay.
If I'm gonna upgrade to 200,000 with the freelance and recommendations we have talked, it's gonna be contingent.
Okay.
Because I have to you know, rediscuss some issues with my client because of her interest in this matter and the amount of money that we're receiving. It certainly, you know, it intrudes in some way with our representation agreement.
Okay.
You know, the fees that I'm supposed to be getting paid and the amount that she's supposed to be receiving.
Okay.
So we're going to have to work out that issue between us.
Okay.
Obviously, I'm not going to drag you into it.
Yeah, okay.
But what I'm saying is I might be willing to agree to 200,000. But it's gonna be contingent on me, you know, talking to her and you
mm-hmm.
saying whether it's gonna work or not in the end.
Okay. Is there any way that we could reframe, like, I'm thinking with the tax, like with the different taxing structures, that could, you know, give you the or make you more confident in your ability to, like, do the deal now? You know, splitting, giving some of this money as a 1099, would that help at all?
Maybe we can do all 1099. Because the thing is, obviously we're going to have to split the money and there are costs that are involved as well.
Yeah,
there's a minimum reservation value that she's willing to receive as well in order to go to settlement. So in terms of costs, cost plus the money that she's going to want, and then if that amount is taxed as well, and she does not receive the money, I mean, to put it in numbers, to make it more visually.
Okay.
If, say that we receive 200,000, and out of those 200,000, 40,000 are taxed. We're out of, with 26, sorry, 160, and my costs are, say, 40,000. And that lives there with 120,000. And that's even less than 125,000 you're willing to pay for 1 year salary. So you may see how she may not be willing to accept a deal that would give her less of the money.
Would she accept something where at the end of the day she ends up, what, 125? When you take out fees, attorney, and all
that? That's what I'm saying. Okay. Like, the way that we could go into that is if we do all 1099, so that's not taxed privately, and then we sort of that issue privately.
I can't do all 1099, but I could do a good portion of it. 1099.
How much proportion?
The most I could do is half.
Half.
Yeah.
Do you know how much was it that was taxed under 1099? How much would you have to withhold?
I don't have any information on how that. Yeah, I don't have that.
Okay, and I'm not sure. I mean, I think it's just colliding. I mean, either we go above 200,000 or we go full 1099. But otherwise, I mean, it's gonna be
because tough. What's concerning you is going under that $125,000. Well, so her 1 year, going under 1 year salary.
No, I'm just providing an example of saying that she has like always some expectations, and if I close a deal that does not meet her expectations, obviously the deal is gonna fall through.
Yeah.
So. Let me see what we're doing. So that's why I'm saying it's gonna be contingent, and we're gonna have to. We'll still have a little bit of time.
Yeah.
So what's it gonna be, Chris? I mean, we have to go either full 1099,
okay,
or above that 200,000.
I can't do the full 1099. What about let me see. With 205,000 help? I'm close. That's something, yeah. All right, let's do one for 210. Let's do 210.
I don't know. I mean, still, let me just check. I'm not sure. I'm really not sure.
You cannot go above that value. I'm gonna have to make it. If I go anything above that, I'm gonna have to make a contingent.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's think for a moment here.
Because
in any case, so in the interest of full disclosure, in the way that an agreement works perfectly for us, that everything is has to be foreseen, is if we receive 250,000. If we do not do that, I mean, I know this time sounds ridiculous coming from the lawyer, but I'm not certain about the other terms of the representation agreement that I have. So in any case, that doesn't go exactly as we were about to it, I'm gonna have to relook at it, and if there is some issue that I have to discuss with the client again. I just don't want to say, you know, we close an agreement and then I just find out that my own agreement precludes me from doing that.
So then, from our perspective, full disclosure, the absolute most that Sal, the CEO, said that we could pay is 250. But the issue is we're not sure if we could pay that.
How is that?
There's some financial difficulty. That's part of the reason why there's a little bit of turnover. And then he said that's going to be very difficult to pay that 250. That's why I'm like, that's going to have to be contingent, like anything above the 210. 210, I think we still should be okay. But once we get in that 250 range, that's when it starts.
And contingent on what? On like receiving his
approval? I'm going to have to take that back because he's indicated that even though that's absolute most he'd be willing to pay in the top end, it'd be difficult to pay that. I don't have any information on like the chances and whatnot, but the closer you get at 250, then it's that obviously like logically more difficult it'll be.
Okay.
So yeah, I'm not comfortable. That's why I'm like, I'm not really comfortable going over 210 without it being contingent, because I don't know if we could pay that.
So obviously we're in a tough spot.
Yeah.
No wonder this is.
Yeah.
The negotiation.
Yeah.
Maybe we would just have to make a contingent. You know, since we're being completely honest, I actually appreciate it. I mean, we're being very honest with each other.
Exactly.
This is that my issue. Like, I'm even willing, in the interest of reaching an agreement, because I believe that we both want to reach an agreement. I can cut my fees. I have like a contingency fee, obviously.
Yeah.
And I'm willing to relinquish my fee, you know, and receive less. But that would mean, like, to put it in as an example, say that I was willing to, out of those 250, I was receiving 1/3. And so obviously we're gonna do 200. If I cover 1/3 plus my costs, that's gonna go into Chris's reservation value.
Okay.
So I could say, okay, I would not receive my 1/3 cut, but I want all that is above your reservation value. So let's say her reservation value was 125, right? And I get 200. So I wanna have that 75 for me, maybe. But doing that is gonna require me taking that back to Chris. Because I don't have any information that I can do that here. And obviously, I'm not going to blindside her and say, okay, you know, this is what you wanted. And like, here's your money. I'm going to take the rest. So I'm going to shark. I'm not going to do that. So if I go 250, then that goes according to what we planned. But if not, I'm going to have to take it back.
So if you go with 250, when you go back to her, that's at her reservation value?
Yeah, no, 250 we close. At 250 we close, no problem.
Yeah, but that's her reservation. So, like, when
you go considering all the cost and my fees and what she wanted,
if you go under 250, you're under her reservation value automatically?
Yeah. That's the issue. I mean, we could go under a little bit, but it's like, you'll be like a $2,000 to $3,000 difference. I mean, and I'm not quite sure. I mean, I don't want to mess it up. Because let me just do the check one more time to make sure. Let's see.
And you don't have any of how much you would save if it's...
Wait, sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Just give me a second. Sorry about that. Completely honest, like the most that I could cut off, I don't want to be, actually, no, I'm not sure. I feel, you know, telling you how much I'm willing to cut off, it's like breaching me, my degree of loyalty to my client.
I understand that.
I mean, we can cut off, but I don't want to compromise her, so obviously I want to get the most for her.
Mm-hmm.
And saying maybe I could go less, I could go $5,000 less, and let me just recheck with that, and let's say 245, for example. We do that.
I think I'd rather make it contingent.
Right.
Yeah.
Because if that's the thing. If we're going to be contingent, we might as well go to 250. That's what I think.
No, I can't.
Like, for me, if it's going to be contingent, there's no difference in going
250
or 230.
It's just, I can't, yeah.
Like, we can do it 250 and be contingent on one.
I mean, I could tell you right now, they won't accept that. Because they said that, they won't accept that.
Good. Just so we're clear, we have 7 minutes.
Yeah, especially since, because like, I think what's a little bit concerning me right now is, it seemed like it was possible to make an agreement at 200K and make it contingent, 210K, make it contingent. And I went there, and then like talking about 250K contingent, we're going kind of like the opposite way. And
what do you mean the opposite way?
Well, because it seemed like you were willing to make an agreement at $200,000 contingent, you know, with the letter of recommendation and the claims released. And then that's a little bit troubling me right now, that now we're at $250,000 contingent when we were at $200,000. And then I did give you, I did give like an additional $10,000.
Mm-hmm.
To try to work with you, and then now we're talking. Yeah, I'm really concerned with that going now to $250,000.
Okay,
making contingent. Yeah.
No, what I'm saying.
I feel like I was trying to work with you on that front.
No, yeah, I understand that.
Yeah,
I appreciate it. No, what I'm saying is like, if I'm gonna go agree, the only way I can agree to right now is to go to 250. That's what I, at least was my agreement with my client.
Mm-hmm.
And the other amount below that is gonna be contingent. That's basically it. And if you're fine with the contingent on that.
All right, if it comes between like 245 and 200 contingent, I'd rather go with 200 contingent, because I could tell you right now, the 245, if it's contingent, from my end, I mean, I'm be honest with you, I don't think they'll accept it. I don't have information on it, like saying they 100% won't.
Okay, so
but based on information I have,
basically,
I doubt it.
We're in the same position.
Yeah.
Like, If it's going contingent, there's no difference for you in going to be the lowest value.
Yeah.
There's no difference when you're going to the highest value. So how about we do this? How about we reach a middle ground on the contingent part? It's going to be contingent anyways.
I'm still troubled because earlier you were fine with 200 making contingent. And then I feel like in me giving you this information is being turned on me. You know what I mean?
What do you mean? Sorry if I did that.
I'm not comfortable with that.
I'm just...
All right, the most I could do and make it is 210.
Okay.
Because, and then, yeah, like, that's, a, like, make it 210.
Okay.
If it's contingent, like, 210.
Okay, so let's make a mix and say 210 contingent, plus recommendation letter, plus non-disclosure, plus release of claim.
Yeah, 210 letter recommendation, non-disclosure, claims released.
And freelance?
Freelance. We need to figure out how much freelance. Let me see how much time we have.
We got very little time.
We got 5 minutes, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
How about 25 of the... No, I think... We can just cut off the freelance. I mean, we can put a freelance as a future opportunity.
Okay.
But not necessarily tie it down to this agreement.
Okay.
And just a little recommendation and.
Okay.
And that's it. The recommendation on disclosure.
And then what tax forms, the W-2?
We can do the 1099.
Okay. The thing is with the 1099 for our reporting purposes, since that is for, you know, for like work,
mm-hmm.
We're going to have a little bit.
Would you have it happen? You say you were willing to go half.
Yeah, that was my limit with that.
I'm giving that my fee.
Yeah,
basically.
So all right, let's do half. So it's gonna be half W-2.
And half 1099.
1099.
And we'll reach 210.
Okay, but if we're, I'm gonna give you half 1099, can she do some consulting, just a little bit?
How much?
$5,000 in worth in fees at $60 an hour.
Okay,
that's the minimum. Okay. So half 1099 form, half W-2.
That consultant is gonna go in W-2, right?
Let's see how they split it up.
Cause that's it.
Yeah. 2 minutes.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So the way it works right here is the 1099 usually goes for consulting stuff, and usually the client's not reporting.
Okay. Can
I just put down? Yeah. It's just a way. Yeah.
Yeah. That's correct. You're right. No, I'm sorry. I confused it a little bit.
Yeah. Okay. Our consulting work really the regular day that actually reaches 6 hours until it reaches 5,000, and that's gonna be part. That's a part of the day. Nice. Up until. Okay, so let me know if I'm correct. So the overall is going to be $210,000 overall package. In this 2010, there's going to be $60 an hour consulting work up until $5,000 of overall 210. Half of the payment is going to be W-2. Half is going to be in 1099. And then their non-disclosure agreement and release of all relevant of all claims. And there's going to be a recommendation talking about, you know, some of her previous work for company.
Okay.
Is that fine?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chris.